Galatians chapter 3. This morning we're going to be looking at verses 15 through 20. And I want you to remember the context and where we are in this book. It really becomes important every week to review and make sure we understand where we are. If you remember, Galatians 1 and 2 was about Paul defending his apostleship. He gets into chapter 3, the end of 2 and into chapter 3, and he begins to defend this understanding of justification. One of the greatest truths that we have in the Word of God is that He has declared us not guilty, that He has declared us righteous. He can do that because the punishment for our sins was paid. Jesus Christ came and died and was the substitute for our sin. He was the substitute. He took the place of us as we should have died. We should have been condemned. We should have been separated from God, yet He took our place on the cross. He purchased our salvation. He purchased our freedom. And so today we stand justified. Now when we get into chapter 3, verses 15 through 20, you're not going to see or really even hear the word justified in this text, but it is the context of what he's talking about. What Paul is beginning to do is he's going to kick the legs out of arguments that he knows are coming from the Judaizers. He has laid this truth that the just shall live by faith. His example was Abraham. And the example of Abraham was that when God came to Abraham and made him a promise, God made Abraham a promise, a covenant, what we would call an unconditional covenant. There's no, if you do this, then I will do this. God simply came to Abraham and he said, I will do this. And what did he tell Abraham he would do? He said, I will give you a land. I'm calling you out of your pagan culture. He didn't call Abraham because Abraham was good and Abraham was righteous and Abraham was worshiping him. When God went to Abraham, Abraham was lost. Abraham was a pagan. He lived among pagans. He lived as a pagan. He worshiped as a pagan. But God called him out. And he made him some promises. A land. That he would become a people, that out of this body of old age, he and his wife, well beyond childbearing years, he made him a promise that seemed so improbable that literally out of him nations would come. He said his descendants would be as the stars, as the sand on the seashore. But that wasn't the end of the promise. It's given to us in Genesis 12. It's given to us in Genesis 15, recounted again, where God says to him, and I, now listen to what God said, not in you, and I will bless all the families, all the nations of the earth through you, Abraham. A promise. This promise has everything to do with justification because the promise pointed to Abraham's seed, and that seed was Jesus Christ. The fulfillment of the promise of God. So when we get to this text, he knew that the Judaizers would begin to say, well, fine, we accept that God gave Abraham a promise, but Paul, have you forgotten that after the promise to Abraham, God then turned around and gave another covenant to the children of God, a covenant of the law. 430 years later, God, through the angels, would speak to Moses, and those angels would deliver to Moses that which God spoke concerning the law, and then Moses himself would become a mediator to the people of God, the children of God. He would declare to them this covenant of God, this conditional covenant, not unconditional, conditional covenant. And Moses stood before the people and he stood before God and he said, if you obey this law, the Ten Commandments, right? If you obey this law, he basically, to sum it up, says, then you will be blessed. However, if you don't keep this law, then guess what? It will bring upon you a curse. The breaking of the law has always brought forth a curse. The disobedience to God has always brought forth a curse, and not just a curse, the same curse. When God told them, don't eat of the tree in the garden, he said, if you do, you will surely die. The wages of sin is what? Death. It always has been. It always will be. Separation from God. Physical death as well. And all that comes with this broken world. That was a conditional covenant. And what we seem to have is two. And now Paul is addressing the question, which came first, the chicken or the egg? Which matters the most? Which supersedes which? Which matters? Which is most important? And folks, this is crucial that we understand what it is that Paul is saying to us today. Now, we live in a culture that seems like promises are broken left and right, doesn't it? I mean, how appropriate in the midst of a political charged season that we every day are reminded as we watch television, how many of you think that every promise that's being made is going to be kept? Good, you ain't suckers. That's good. And it doesn't matter the party. The reality is we live in a climate. How many times have we heard no new taxes, right? And what do we keep getting? We keep getting taxes. We keep getting promised change that in Washington, we're all going to get along, right? We're going to find a way to work together. We're going to reach across the aisle and get things done. How many times have we heard that promise? But listen, it's not just over there. There are many children in this room that would say, I have parents that make promises all the time they don't keep. There are marriages in this room that, you know what the reality is? They're based on a covenant, aren't they? They're based on a promise. You remember we stood up one day, all of us that are married, and we made some promises, didn't we? I will love you. I will what? Cherish you. See, Emily's about to get married. She knows all about this. You better get it right, all right? You better get it right. Get these words, all right? Her wedding's coming up in just a couple short weeks. I will cherish you. I will honor you. Let me ask a question. Is there any marriage in here that would say, I have kept those three promises all the way through without any problem? Nobody? Good. You're telling the truth this morning. Because all of us know what it is to break a promise. We live in a culture that more and more and more, it's harder to find the times that a promise is kept. It's easy to find when promises are broken, but I want you to know today, if nothing else, I hope that you gain from this text, we have a God, we serve a God, that when He makes a promise, you know what? He keeps it. Every single promise that God has ever made to you and to me, He has kept them. He will continue to keep them because we serve a God that is completely faithful. And you better praise this same God that He is faithful even if we are what? Even if we're faithless. Even when we are faithless. God absolutely is faithful. That's the God that we serve. And when we get to this text, listen to what He has to say. In verse 15, He says, brethren, I speak in terms of human relations. He's going to give us an example that everybody can understand, even though it's only a man's covenant. So He's going to compare God's covenant to a man's covenant. He says, even all of you out there today, you understand the nature of a covenant, even in this broken, beat up world, right? The idea of a covenant is that we come to an agreement. And when the two parties come to an agreement, they ratify with a signature the covenant, right? And once it is made, there's no changing the covenant. You have to keep the covenant. Nothing can undo it. Nothing. You understand what I'm saying? That's what He's getting at here. Even in this broken world, we get the nature and understanding of a covenant. Even though it's only a man's covenant, yet when it has been ratified, no one sets it aside or adds conditions to it. Now the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. He's about to make a point here. You need to underline it in your Bible. He says that the promise was concerning a seed, plural or singular? Singular, good. You know your English as well. It's singular because from the very beginning, all the way back with Adam and Eve, this is when this idea of a seed that would be coming. He told Eve, there will be enmity between Satan and your seed. Singular. Meaning that there was coming from Adam and Eve one day a redeemer. And Satan would strike his heel. You remember that text out of Genesis 3:15? That he would strike the heel of Eve's seed, but that her seed would crush his head. From that moment on, we have been looking towards who is that seed. From that moment, they began to look towards a Christ. Christ is not the last name of Jesus. Christ is a title. Jesus the Christ. We say Jesus Christ, but technically Jesus the Christ, the anointed one, the Messiah, the promised one. He says a promise was made to Abraham. They were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. He does not say, and to seeds, as referring to many. Now, we mistake that so many times with Abraham, because when we think about the promise to Abraham, we remember God said, your descendants, out of you will come descendants that number the stars and the sands on the seashore, right? But ultimately, he kept that promise, and yes, multiple seeds, and out of him came nations. But the reality is, he did all of that so that one might come. The focus was always on the seed. And he says, it refers not to many, but rather to one, and to your seed, that is Christ. What I am saying is this. The law which came 430 years later does not invalidate a covenant previously ratified by who? God. That's going to be important. So as to nullify the promise. For if the inheritance is based on the law, it's no longer based on a promise. But God has granted it to Abraham by means of a promise. Why the law then? It was added because of transgression. Having been ordained through angels, by the agency of a mediator, which is Moses, until the seed would come to whom the promise had been made. Now, a mediator is not for one party only, whereas God is only one. This morning, I want to point out to you four facts that you need to understand out of these verses that will help us understand the relationship that exists between the promise of God and the law of God. First, this morning, I want you to see that grace was promised before the law was given. Let me say that again. First point, grace was promised before the law was given. What matters to us the most is that God Himself made us a promise. One of the things that is so interesting about this promise that was made to Abraham is when you go back to Genesis chapter 15, there's a part of the story that we kind of scratch our head and we don't really understand the significance of it because it means nothing to us in a Western culture, but in their culture, it's clearly understood. When men got together to make a covenant, they would often come and they would bring sacrifices. And what they would do was they would take the sacrifices, they would divide them in half, they would lay them on the altar, and when they ratified the covenant, those who were part of the covenant, guess what they would do? They would walk between the altars of sacrifice, thus signifying that they would keep their promise. When you go to Genesis 15, the reason for that chapter is because Abraham was starting to waver a little bit. Abraham was struggling, as was Sarah, about this promise that they would have a land and that they would have children, especially because Abraham is now knocking 100 years old and he's kind of looking at God going, when are you going to keep the promise? God, are you going to keep this promise? And God kindly and gently draws him out of his tent and he says, look at the stars. That's when he tells him, that's going to be your descendants. And Abraham goes to sleep, and in the midst of that sleep, God gives him this vision of these animals being slaughtered, put in half, put on altars on each side, and it says that God alone walked through the sacrifice, signifying who was going to keep the promise? God. What was Abraham doing during the ratification of this promise? He was asleep. He added nothing to it. He contributed nothing to it. What was he doing? He was asleep. But God showed him in that vision and dream, this is what I will accomplish. It didn't depend on Abraham at all. God didn't say, Abraham, if you do this, then I will do this. God simply states, this is what I'm going to do. And you know what? Abraham simply believed God. How do you know he believed God? How do you know he believed God? Church, how do you know he believed God? If you tell me you believe I can carry you across on a tightrope, how am I going to know that you really believe it? When you get up on my back and let me carry you, right? If I say I can carry you across, you can say all day long, oh yeah, Pastor Aaron, I think you can do it. I know you got it. But what about when I say, okay, good, you think I can do it? Come on, get on my back. Now we're talking faith, right? Faith isn't just talk. Faith is action. Faith without works is what? Dead. And we know that Abraham had faith and that Abraham believed because he acted upon that which God said because he believed God was true for his word. And he left his family and he wandered in that wilderness, didn't he? Grace was promised before the law was given. I want you to see that it was God who made the promise. It says, when you go up to verse 16, now the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. And the reality is, it is God who is making the promise. It's not Abraham making a promise to God. Listen, how many of you have made promises to God and broken them? All of you. You know how I know that? Because I've done it a million times myself. God, I won't do this. God, I will do this. And lo and behold, what do we find? We're faithless, right? We're not faithful. We're faithless. That's not God. Thank God our salvation does not hinge on you and me. But it hinges on a promise of a seed that God would send a Messiah, an anointed one to come and save us from our sins. And it wasn't that Abraham made a promise. God made a promise, an unconditional promise. The grace was promised before the law was ever given, and it was binding. Secondly, the law cannot alter the promise of grace. This is where the Judaizers, he knew they would be going. He knew that they would say, fine, we believe that God made a promise to the children of Israel, but we believe that he also came behind the promise and he gave us the law. The law is not like the promise. Here is what the law is. The law is what we call a conditional covenant. That means if then. If you do this, then you'll be blessed. If you don't, then you will be cursed. The problem with the law, simply stated, is the law can add nothing to the promise. The promise was from God. Has nothing to do with the law. You can't take a contract and add to it, can you? You can't nullify it, can you? And he says the law neither nullifies, the law neither adds to it. Now we're going to get to, okay, then why the law? We're going to answer that today. But he is laying down this fact that the law does not nullify the promise of God's grace. It's simple. Grace plus nothing equals salvation. You do realize that, right? We got to lay this foundation in Galatians. It's grace plus nothing. If you add anything to grace, guess what it stops being? Grace. Because grace is God's unmerited favor. How many of y'all have been Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts? Boy Scouts, you have merit badges, don't you? That means that you look in a book and it tells you. If you want a camping badge, you have to do this, 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 and this. And if you do all that, you have merited, you have earned that badge. Right? Now, you have to keep your end of it. If you don't do what you've been asked to do, if you do this, you get the badge. If you don't do it, guess what? You don't get the badge. So after you've done it, you can almost walk up and say, listen, you owe me that badge because I earned it. That is the opposite of grace. We stand before God and there is nothing we can plead. There is nothing we can say. There is no tipping the scales. People think that they're going to go to heaven. There's something deep within us that makes us want to believe that we're good enough. We usually do that by saying, I'm not Hitler, I'm not Osama bin Laden, right? If you put me up next to them, then I am good. The problem is they're not the standard. You won't be compared to them. You will be compared to God, whose law you broke. The law came 430 years after the promise. And Paul's argument, he's really just arguing logically here. He's saying, if you know a contract cannot be added to or annulled, then the reality is the law coming after, it obviously serves a purpose, but it doesn't undo what has already been done. It is still, from the beginning, grace plus nothing. You see, they did what all of us want to do. We want to say grace plus something. All of us at our heart want to do that. You live that way practically. You know how I know that? Because when you sin, you still want to go hide from God, don't you? You're forgetting. I don't know, that's poor English. You are forgetting this one reality. You've been justified and you've been declared what? You've been declared righteous. And so when you sin, a person that really gets, it's not grace plus something that I have God's favor. It's not grace plus something that I can go into God's presence. It's not grace plus something that God will love me. Then that makes a person who gets justification run to Jesus when they're struggling in sin. But there are so many of us that live practically the other way around. God can't speak to me. God can't deal with me. God can't see me. God won't want to be near me. God won't accept me. God won't receive me. God won't hear me. Because we've said it's grace plus something. The law cannot alter the promise of grace that was given to us. The promise is binding. Moses added nothing to the promise by giving us the law. He takes nothing away from the promise by adding to the law. You cannot add to grace or it ceases to be grace. All this points to one truth that is undeniable. Grace was promised before the law was given. The law cannot be altered. The law cannot alter the promise of grace. But thirdly, by grace, through faith, that's how we receive this promise. Here is a truth that I want you to know and understand. Man's imperfections cannot satisfy God's perfections. Did you hear that? Man's imperfections cannot satisfy God's perfections. There's no scale in heaven by which you will be able to say, God, look at all the good that I did. Do you realize that what the law simply states to us is that once you break the law, you are a what? A sinner, a lawbreaker, right? How many of you are adulterers in this room? See, everybody's, what? How many of you, let me put it another way. How many of you have looked after a man or a woman that was not your spouse and lusted after them? Chickens. Oh, you are such chickens. Well, I'm not a murderer. Are you sure? Because Jesus says that murder begins not in the physical act of murder, but you know where he says murder begins? When you hate your brother. Let me ask you a question now. How many of you are murderers? See, y'all are like first service. Everybody's like, I ain't raising my hand to the adulterer question. I don't care how he phrases it. I don't care how he puts it. My wife is sitting right beside me. That's the thing about the scale. One sin tips the scale. I can't go before a judge tomorrow and say, listen, judge, I robbed that bank, but I've never robbed a bank in my life before that day. And not only that, let me tell you how good a man I am. I mean, I go to church, I tithe, I help old ladies across the street, I mowed a guy's yard next to me because his family was in the hospital and he just needed some help. And you know what? Whenever we have this going on, I'm always faithful. And we just keep adding and adding and adding as if somehow we can tip the scale in heaven so that it looks like the good outweighs the bad. No, here is the condition. Here is the seriousness of our heart's condition. We are so wretched and so wicked. On so many levels, the reality is, I don't think there's anybody in this room that the good would outweigh the bad, number one. Number two, that's not how justice works. I would have to stand before a judge and he would say, it doesn't matter what you've done or what you were or how you acted before, the reality is, did you steal? And I would have to say, yes. And he would say, there's a punishment for stealing. The idea of a big grand scale in heaven is so wrong and so misguided. It just speaks to our flesh because there's something in us that wants to stand before God and say, look what I did. Instead of standing before God and saying, look at the mess that I am. God help me. You see, we're not saved by obeying the law because the law condemns. We're saved when we believe the promise of God, and it's by grace through faith that we receive the promise that was given to Abraham that we would indeed be blessed because of the seed that came, that took on flesh, that hung on a cross, that died for my sins, was buried, and rose again. If you're leaning on anything other than the promise of God, then here is the truth that you need to grasp. You're in default. You have a debt that you cannot pay. Spiritually, the Bible says that you are destitute. But here's the promise. The riches of God have been given to us through His Son who paid the price for our sins. Do you believe that this morning? And you say, well, I'm a Christian. Of course I believe that. Listen, we're dealing with a church here made up of believers who are struggling with the same thing that we struggle with today. We struggle with grace plus. Grace plus. Grace plus. Grace plus nothing brings about the promise of God, which is our salvation. Lastly, he answers the all-important question. He's laid down a great argument. You can't undo the promise of God. It was made. It was settled. He made it. It doesn't depend on us. The law, yes, it was given, but it doesn't undo what was already promised. So then that leads you to this question, this place, which is my fourth point. Why the law then? It has to have a place. It has to have a purpose. We can't look at it and say, well, it has no purpose. God gave the law just like He gave the promise, but He's saying one doesn't undo the other. Then what is the law all about? He answers it very simply in verse 19. Why the law then? It was added because of transgression. You know what transgression is? It's very simple. Transgression is the idea that God has said, thou shalt and thou shalt not. That God has said, just like in the garden, He said, you can have everything in the garden, but there's one thing that you shall not eat of, and that is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Right then, He set up a standard, didn't He? And when man transgressions, it simply means that we cross the line. We cross the standard. All have sinned and fall short of what? The glory of God. The glory of God is the standard. It is how we will be compared, not to Hitler, to God. You're not going to stand in line and you don't be praying, well, I hope I get behind the worst sin in the world so when I get up there, I look way better. That you're misunderstanding it all. He says the law was given because man transgresses. In fact, it's in man's nature to transgress. The problem with most believers today, you want to know, I'll help you out today. You know why most of you struggle so badly in sin? Very, very simple. You compromise too often. You say, well, how do I compromise? Because when God gives you a line, rather than doing with that line what you need to do, God tells us in the New Testament especially, very clearly, over and over, He will say, flee from what? Flee from sin. Flee from youthful lust. You know what that is saying? When God draws the line, you don't get all up on it. That's why most of us, you know why most of you struggle in sin? If you're an alcoholic, don't go in a bar. Because you know what's going to happen, right? You just draw the line and you think, well, you know, well, this is the way I'm going to live my life. I'm going to live as close to the line as I can possibly live without crossing the line. You know that you are destined to transgress the law, don't you? You have a sinful nature inside of you that is competing against the Spirit of God that lives inside of you. And if you keep on that line, you know what's going to happen, right? Yeah, and the problem is, here's what's so silly. That line, you know what it really represents? You're thinking, oh, it represents mom being mad at me, or it represents somebody not thinking I'm as good as I want them to think I am. No, no. What the line represents, death. I would call you a complete fool if I took you to a mountain cliff that was sheer and straight down, and there is the cliff, and you are trying to get as far on that edge as you could. I would say, how dumb are you? What is wrong with you? You realize that one slip, what happens? Yeah, so let me tell you, let me put it this way. You think it's cute to flirt at work. Do you realize that you are on the line? And that flirting can so easily, just like that, become an affair. Well, I'm just going to stay on the line. It doesn't matter as long as I don't cross the line. You live like that, you will cross the line. Flee it. Run from it. He's saying, I've laid out these standards so that you can recognize that that is death. That is a curse, and you can get away from it. I mean, if it was a lion, what would you do? You're doggone right. I would. I mean, you're crazy if you don't. You put an alligator in a closet in my house, I'm not going in the closet. I'm not doing it. I don't care how big it is. I don't care how far away it is. You put an alligator, I'm not going in there, and I'm certainly not going to go up and go, doink, doink. See, he didn't bite me. Because eventually you're going to do it, and what's going to happen? He's going to snap that arm and rip it off your body. Right? He gave us those things so that we could recognize the transgression. The death that is looming, that comes with sin, the destruction that it brings into our lives. That's why He gave us the law, but the law was never intended to save. All the law could do was go, see, that's sin. Look where you're at. You're over here. Where do you need to be? Over here. Okay, you've sinned, you've messed up. Now what do you do? Now you're a lawbreaker. Now you deserve death. Now what do you do? Because you didn't just transgress it once, you transgressed it 1,000 times. It was meant to drive you back to the Savior. The law was meant to drive you back to the promise. That ultimately your greatest need is what? Jesus Christ, grace, mercy. It defines sin for us. It helps us diagnose our problem. How can you be healed from a problem you don't know that you have? The law simply says that's cancer and it's going to kill you. And now look, you've stepped over it. Now what do you do? What's the cure? You better find the cure. The law was conditional. If then. That means you had a responsibility in it, and I can tell you, you miserably failed in your obligation and responsibility. And now it drives you back to God. where the law depended on two people keeping it, the promise depends on how many? How many? How many, church? One. One. The promise depends on one. The law depends on two. You're part of that equation, and you have royally messed up. And it drives us back to the one who cannot fail, who is never faithless, who is always faithful. And church, as Kevin comes this morning, I would declare to you, it is better. You need to hear this. You need to write this down. It is better. Paul is simply arguing and saying, having heard all of this, don't you agree that it is better to depend on the grace of an unchanging God, a faithful God, a true, trusted God? Is it not better to depend on His grace than to cling to your own hopeless efforts? Some of you need to stop fighting with God today and accept the glorious truth that He loved you so much, He made a way where there wasn't a way. And He did for you what you couldn't do for yourself. And He's not looking for you to earn your salvation. He's looking for you to die to yourself, to trust Him for His salvation, and to let Him have your life. And His life will never lead you toward the death that you were living in before. In reality, this morning, whether you're a believer, whether you have come and you don't know Christ as Lord and Savior, I beg you this morning to abandon your hopeless pursuit. Did you hear what I said? I beg you to abandon your hopeless pursuit, your endless struggle. That means it never, ever ends. You trying to please God, you trying to earn it, deserve it, and make it happen. It's an endless struggle. What I am asking you today is to bring yourself, and I'm asking you to bring your sin to Jesus. The world and sin is so brutal. What you've made of your life is so utterly destroyed. Without the mighty hand of God, it can't be fixed. But under His hand, under the blood of Jesus, do you realize that there's nothing that is impossible? He can save your marriage. He can save your life. He can save your relationships. Everything that you are toiling under, and it never seems to be made right, it's because you're trusting in a law that cannot save instead of dying to yourself and coming up under the promise that could never fail. So I beg you, abandon your hopeless pursuit, your endless struggle. Bring yourself and your sin to God. His grace opens His arms. It opens His arms to us. And we find ourselves at peace with God when we trust in the promise of God. And you know what the most amazing thing is? God doesn't have to be your judge. What He really desires to be is your Father. Let that sink in. Because the law, you know what? The law no longer has any effect on us if we're under Christ. The law was temporary until Jesus came. And now He says, I can set you free from the law. I can forgive you. I've paid the price. There's nothing left that the law can do to you because the price has been paid. So depend on the promise. He wants to be your friend. He wants to be your Father. But if you are determined to earn it yourself, what you will find at the end of time, He will be a faithful, righteous judge who will condemn you to hell and give you what you truly deserve. He says, come, all you are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you what? Rest. Some of you need rest so desperately. Run to the Savior. He is the only source of rest. Give your life to Him today. If you're not a believer, repent of your sins. Cry out to Jesus to save you from those sins. Give Him your life. He will change you. Make Him king. That means you have to die. He has to live. You have to let go of your life and let Him have control of it. And I promise you, He will lead you into righteousness and joy and peace like you've never known. Or you can keep doing it your way. How's it working for you? Not good. Christian, what have you said, grace plus? Put it aside. Stop living in the bushes and come out into the light of God, into the grace of God, and let Him help you, even with all of your sin and all of your mistakes. Quit trying to make for yourself some fig leaves to cover what God can so plainly and easily see. Don't go back to works when He saved you by grace. And maybe you're here today and you just need to be part of a church family. I pray that today you'll come. I can't think of a better church than this church. God is moving here. He's speaking through His word here. This is a family where you'll be loved. You need to be part of a local church so you can serve. What's keeping you from joining this fellowship? So today, as He calls you, let's stand. Will you answer His call? Will you spend this time praying and speak back? God has spoken.